Random House Roads presents Hangfire, Starfist, Book 6, by David Sherman and Dan Cragg. Read for you by John Bedford Lloyd. Looming black against the bright sunlight from the arena, two gladiators clomped under the arch and down the corridor to the dressing rooms. Filmed with sweat, breathing hard, they congratulated each other on their performance. The crowd had loved them, despite the Emperor's disappointing decision to spare the loser. Outside, the spectators screamed and stomped their feet, demanding another performance. They'd get it. The two paused briefly in front of where Gilboa Woods sat wearily, one arm chained to the wall, his face showing signs of recent beatings. He was dressed as a lightly armored secutor, as befit the Caligulan theme of the park. The gladiator said nothing, just nodded sympathetically and passed on down the corridor. Woods's turn was coming up soon. Notodrea shifted his huge bulk comfortably and put an arm around his nearest consort. He held up his goblet and a servant, a real boy, not one of those idiotic servo mechs, poured more wine. Other members of the Drea family, lolling about in the Emperor's box above the stadium, saluted him with their goblets. "Long life, boss," Noto's counselor said across the rim of his goblet. The crowd had grown silent, their attention riveted on the two new men circling one another in the dusty arena below. They bore the arms and armor of first-century gladiators. The Pompeian was the odds-on favorite, but his opponent, trained in Capua, was a good contender. Of course, the gladiators who fought in the Havanagas Roman theme park actually trained in modern facilities. But one attraction of the park was that it recreated precisely the atmosphere of Imperial Rome circa AD 37 to 41, the reign of the Emperor Caligula. Exact reproductions of the amphitheater, the gladiatorial schools, the whole city of Rome, in fact, existed for the pleasure of the park's 25th century patrons. The other attraction was blood. The sharp sound of the Pompeian sword against the Capuan's shield brought the crowd to its feet. Noto grinned. He was sponsoring the Pompeian, so he stood to win a substantial bet if his man won. The Capuan darted inside his opponent's guard, and his sword stabbed at the Pompeian's left leg, slicing upward and drawing blood. Not an incapacitating wound, but the first of the battle. The crowd went wild.
"One for me," a tiny voice said in Noto's left ear. He glanced downward toward a spectator box and grimaced at Johnny Styx. Styx, counselor to the Ferris family, grinned.
"Hey, up yours, Johnny," Noto whispered into his throat mic. "Tell Homs I got your man by the balls."
Homs, head of the Ferris family, looked up and waved cordially at Noto. Homs had been emperor last month, and Noto had lost heavily to him then. The Pompeian suddenly rained blows against the Capuan's shield, driving him back. The Capuan staggered under the onslaught, tripped, and fell backward. He rolled, jumped to his feet, and slashed his attacker across the right forearm. Hidden back in the shadows under the gladiator's arch, a trainer spoke into a throat mic.
"Slow it down, boys. Slow it down," he cautioned the fighters. "Drag the fight out. They expect it. See if you can go a full 10 minutes this bout."
Obediently, the two slowed to circling one another warily. Noto turned to his counselor.
"When's our boy up?"
"Next, boss. Everything's ready."
"You sure they can't jump up into the stands?"
"Sure, boss. The vet operated on their leg tendons, but they're still plenty dangerous. He won't last long."
The families particularly enjoyed shoving captured agents into the arena because what happened to them was real. Suddenly, a scream of delight erupted from the spectators as the two gladiators leaped at each other, furiously hacking and smashing. Then they were on the ground, rolling in the dust. Their weapons flung aside on impact, they were using heads, elbows, feet, and fists. Using a wrestling maneuver, the Capuan managed to throw the Pompeian off and jump to his feet. He retrieved his sword and, before the other man could recover, placed its blade under the Pompeian's chin. The fight was over. The Capuan looked up at the Emperor's box. Noto leaned over the railing, his ample body quivering with rage. His first reaction was to get rid of his defeated fighter. If he did that, though, he couldn't put the man back into the arena for the rest of the month, and despite his loss, the Pompeian was still Noto's best chance to win big another time. Noto gave the thumbs up. The crowd booed and cursed as one. People threw things into the arena. A wave of angry sound washed over the Emperor's box.
"Fuck you!" Noto shouted back. "Who runs this place, me or you?"
he asked in a lower voice. He turned to his counselor.
"They want blood? All right, give them woods."
For 6 years, Noto Drea had been head of the Drea family since removing his brother. The Dreas had joined with the Ferris family to run their enterprise on Havanagas some 20 years ago, but the bitter wars between the two crime families that had once characterized their relations were not so far in the past that they'd been forgotten. Now Noto was head of the family. As soon as he could manage it, the Ferrises, too, would be history. Then he would deal with the local rebels. But for the moment, he would show the Ministry of Justice it couldn't send its agents to spy on him. Two burly guards came for Woods.
"Rawr, rawr,"
Woods mumbled. The guards ignored his request for water. Noto had had his tongue cut out. No matter what he screamed in the arena, nobody would understand him. The guards hauled him to his feet and half-carried, half-pushed him toward the sunlit archway leading into the arena. One of the guards thrust a short-bladed sword into his hand and shoved him out into the amphitheater. The floor of the arena was empty. As the crowd began to chant,
"Bring on the fight! Bring on the fight!"
Woods stared at the wall opposite him, waiting for his opponent to emerge. The roar swept over Woods. Suddenly, the opponent's door clanged open. For a full 30 seconds, nothing emerged from the black square. Then two agile, bipedal reptilian creatures bound into the amphitheater, and the crowd gasped. Behind them, two more scaly animals colored in irregular stripes of yellow, green, and brown appeared in the doorway. Their heads, half the length of a man's forearm, had gaping jaws lined with fearsome, serrated teeth. Their massive hind legs had three dagger-like claws on each foot. Stubby forearms held shorter but no less lethal-looking claws. The creatures stood a meter tall. Disoriented by the roar of the crowd, the beasts tried to leap the walls into the crowd at first, but the severed tendons in their legs prevented them from jumping that high. And then they saw Woods and bound toward him. Woods placed the tip of his blade just under his sternum and threw himself to the ground as hard as he could. The crowd screamed in anger and disappointment as the blade pierced his chest. But they settled down as the beasts set about reducing Woods's body to red chunks. It was snowing heavily in Fargo on the day Assistant Attorney General Tom Nast met with Madam Chang Sturdivant, President of the Confederation Council. Nast had come up with a plan to gather the evidence he needed to break up the mob's activities on Havanagas, the leisure world owned and operated by some of the biggest crime families in the Confederation. Almost every agent sent to Havanagas so far had died. Nast had managed to keep two alive because he was the only person in the ministry who knew their identities. But to carry off his plan, Nast required presidential authority.
"Good to see you again, Mr. Nast," Madam Chang Sturdivant said as Nast took his seat in her office.
"Well, you asked for 30 minutes, and time's a-wasting."
Nast cleared his throat. "Ma'am, as we all know, Havanagas is owned and ruled by several crime families. We've been trying to get inside the organization there to obtain the evidence we need to put them out of business. But the agents sent to Havanagas never live long enough to make a report. We've lost 6 over the last few months, murdered in the most horrible fashion." He described briefly what had happened to Gilboa Woods. "And murder is not the only crime the mob's committed," Nast continued. "There's also the slave trade. They sell young women and children throughout human space to be used as prostitutes. They're also making millions off the illegal traffic in drugs like Thule."
"Yes, Madam Chang."
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.